But again, the question is, it's a food supplement. It is not going to harm the body, right? So I don't see any prescription of orthopedic surgeon which does not contain either of the two drugs in any prescription. So they do give. And I believe they go it with an idea that it does not harm. If the patient can afford it, fine. But I can assure you, it really does not have an effect as far as osteoporosis.
Well, coming to the end of this, may I make a few personal comments? It is an OTC, over-the-counter drug in US. Probably it could not make it to the ethical group because its effect is not well known. Yes, in vitro studies have shown that it has got some non-steroidal anti-inflammatory effect. And this is probably the relief which it gives. However, remember, there is a. It has gone into the category of fast-moving consumer goods section. There is a firm which sells cosmetics, is marketing this. I won't mention the name, but yes, it's not going to. Unless we have a specific module, an arthroscopic study preoperatively, where you study the defects in the cartilage, administer this drug for a prolonged period, see its side effect, and then have another arthroscopic evaluation, then it should be the answer. We should get an answer. Till that time, follow your conscience, follow other factors. Thank you very much.
There was one study of arthroscopic evaluation, but it failed.
That was also not conclusive.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I think now we go to the debate number two. A very interesting topic itself. Whether the thesis is relevant for post-graduation examination, MS, or not. So, we start with Dr. Vineet Sharma. Probably, he will speak against. His views are that thesis should not be made compulsory. Let us hear from him.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, and whosoever is in the audience. I expected postgraduates to be here. I'll prove that I'm not in favor of thesis.
Yes, sir.
I think this debate also has been going on for ages now. And the conclusion, let me tell you the conclusion which has come from the ICMR and the research group. They say it should be compulsory. The points that I am giving will show you that probably what statistics I am giving you and what information I am giving you, this may not be necessary. We may have alternatives for a thesis. Let me be very clear. I am not against PG research. I am very much for it. My views do not intend to hurt anyone's feelings. And I will just try to make few points focusing only on MD-MS thesis. We'll try to explain that we have to make some introspections and healthy discussions, and we need a radical change to help our residents. Types of thesis we have: MD-MS, MPhil, DNB, DMMCH, PhD, MD-PhD. I'll only talk about MD-MS, nothing else. MD-MS, we have 25,000 PG seats in India, 80% in MCI, 20% National Board of Examinations, 2/3 of the MCI seats the government institutions, and more than 4/5 of the NB seats are in private institutions. By and large, those who do not qualify the MCI seats enroll in NBE. As per NBI and MCI-NB systems, PG conduct original research work under a faculty. Remember, original research work under a faculty guide mentor and submit it as thesis dissertation prior to appearing for the examination. For long, a topic of ongoing debate in different forums, it has been cited that 85% of MD-MS thesis work is wasteful or inefficient. It is done on the desktop at the type of submission with copy-paste from internet, plagiarism, and intelligent, sometimes nonsense manipulations. Purchases from the market or steal somebody else's work. A reasonable good document can be produced without any work thanks to information explosion on the internet and the education business mafia. Students produce fat, superfluous documents without good study design and data by compulsion. Imagine the paper load of print thesis of 25,000 students per year, of which hardly 5% or less are worth for work or publishing. Still, we advocate, because of the sword of publish or perish, for a beginner to procure a job for a faculty for promotions. Cost of the thesis. Have you ever calculated the cost of 25 theses per bond per year borne by the students, which averages 15 to 20,000 per thesis, approximately 20 crores. Institutions on evaluation, postage on parcel, evaluation remuneration, keeping, manpower, miscellaneous, approximately 25 crores. These are only gross visible calculations. Hidden costs like leave absenteeism and others not taken into account. Faculty and students will have the free time for thinking, performing, innovations and so on. Saving of productive skilled man are directly affecting the country's GNP. The money so saved can be used in students and faculty development programs, more fellowships, incentive students and so on. Now who is culprit? Is it only residents or we are also involved? How many of us are good in research and methodology? Number one, is an average so-called postgraduate teacher competent enough to take up the responsibility of good researcher or trainer of PGs? And how many of us are competent to do that? How many of us have an understanding of statistical methods and interpretation? I am talking this because at present the number of medical colleges that are coming up and the quality of teachers that we have there is, in my opinion, is horrifying. Dependent on statisticians who literally exploit the students, not too many good statisticians are available. Do we have enough time out of daily schedules with an overload of UGs, PGs, MD, and MS and PhDs, and most of our hospitals are overburdened with clinical work? How many government institutions have electronic medical records? Hardly, I think, 1 or 2%. Are we honest in data collection? How often do we do manipulations in data cooking? I think 85% of us. Is it essential that a good teacher would be a good researcher? Well, yes, he should be. How many of us are committed, sincere, and role models? That is a question to answer. What will happen if this research work continues? We all quote standard references and cross references in books whenever we come across a problem case and think of evidence-based medicine. This is what our previous generation observed and published and ultimately appeared in standard textbooks which are quoting as references. Now just imagine, you may have managed to publish even in a good impact factor journal in spite of knowing in your heart that the data was falsified, multiplied or manipulated. Sooner or later, this will appear in standard text as reference and that will be read and quoted by our next generation. What are we doing? Is it evidence-based medicine based on falsification? Aren't we creating rot in the literature? What are we leading to? Education without values, creating more clever devils. Thank you. There are four slides which I wanted to show, but that will be after Dr. Sherwani speaks.
Yeah, Dr. Sherwani, I think it was a very forceful presentation by Dr. Vineet against the thesis, and he has made your job more exciting, I'll say, and challenging.
I'll give you the alternative. The next three slides show the
alternative. Well, there are alternatives for everything. But you know, if there are problems in the system, it does not mean put in an atom bomb and spoil, finish the system. Well, I brought greetings from Aligarh. And I am grateful for the topic. Thesis writing for PG degree is not relevant and I am most certainly against the topic. And there are reasons for that. Let us assess what a thesis means. It is a document submitted in support of candidature for an academic degree or professional qualification presenting the author's research. The term thesis comes from Greek word meaning something put forth. It refers to an intellectual proposition. Yes, there may be problems. Research and thesis writing has been an integral part of postgraduate curriculum for ages. However, I do agree with my worthy opponent that no formal teaching of research and research methodology is provided to the students. And the issue becomes especially relevant to surgical branches like orthopedics, where both the guides and students have no formal training and research methods. But shall we really finish it off, or shall we improve upon it? Writing a thesis involves not only self-regulation by the student, but goal setting, skill acquisition, motives, attitudes, and one's conception of learning. Why is it necessary? I will tell you. Thesis makes them learn how to do research. Steps involved in research methodology are understood. It helps them to understand the principle of writing. Thesis teaches them how to review the literature for a particular topic. You finish it off and they stop reviewing the literature. It teaches them how to write paper for publication. Writing a good thesis is the first step towards publication in a peer-reviewed journal. Well, why is it necessary? Because it acquaints them with different styles of referencing, alphabetical arrangement, Vancouver style as they appear in the text. They will never know if they are not writing the thesis. Thesis teaches regular follow-up of patients in a systematic manner. Yes, most of the government hospitals are not equipped with the electronic maintenance of the records. But then that is the time when our students, they learn the regular follow-up. It helps in development of art of record keeping. Working on thesis and meeting deadlines brings good discipline not only to writing skill but also in other aspects of training. Research and thesis writing helps in development of scientific thought process, evidence-based medical practice, publications. All these are part and parcel and related to thesis writing. Thesis is an effort for development of new methods and opinions at institutional level. For example, in my medical college where I am working, several theses have opened new horizons. In early 90s, internal fixation in compound fractures. I gave a thesis in 1993 or 94, and there was a time when internal fixation was started in compound fractures. Before that, it was a taboo. Short course antibiotic therapy during the last 4-5 years. I mean, we used to use 15-day antibiotic therapy, 17-day antibiotic therapy. Now we are stopping after 24 hours, at least for planned surgery and clean cases. DDH, recently, I mean, some expertise on DDH by the pediatric orthopedic surgeon during the last 5-7 years. So really, they have certainly opened up new horizons in our institution. Good thesis opens gates for future research because it comes forward with recommendations. There are policy implications, and it opens up doors for new grants you can apply and get. For example, success of Ponseti technique in infants has opened up future research for neglected cases, grown-up children. Thesis work presented in the seminars, you know, in our institution they present 3 times the thesis. It is critically analyzed by all the faculty in the department. They are friends, they give inputs. It enhances confidence of the postgraduate students, develops skills for defending the views and findings before the examiner in the final examination. They know how to argue and how to put forward their point of view in a better way. Thesis enables how to make publications and presentations. In this very conference, more than 100 papers are presented by young people from their thesis. So if it was not for the thesis, then the conference presentations would have suffered. And the postgraduate, they come to know about the ethical issues Even we learn a lot on the ethical issues, how to experiment on animals, other ethical issues. You know, we are dealing with the SMS language generation. Tell me the full form of SQDHI. I mean, static quadriceps drill. Most of the boys and girls, they speak this language. Either you let them study, review the literature, let them write papers, let them write theses, or they will carry on becoming more expert on SMS language. It is all leads to discussions and debates. After writing thesis, they learn all that, how to debate, how to discuss. Thesis has been an integral part of the postgraduate training. So really, in order to sum up, it helps in overall personality development of postgraduate students, prepares them for a rational thinking and scientific thought process. Thanks for listening. Yes, I will also
come. Yeah, now before Dr. Vinit Sharma, I just want to make comment that Dr. Sherwani, the bombs which you had in your armamentarium, it matched with what Dr. Vinit Sharma, Professor Vinit Sharma produced from his side. I think that the debate is so balancing. And another comment I want to make, this debate,
excuse me,
whatever the contents were displaced were of a very high standard. I really enjoyed each and every slide. So I think that is how it should be.
Now, Dr. Sherwani, don't understand me wrong. I'm talking
just about 85%. Just a minute. I want to make a comment. Well, Dr. Sherwani mentioned that primary internal fixation and compound fractures. I remember in 1973 in Pune, we had a thesis in BHU Varanasi in 1973, primary internal fixation and compound fractures. And the moment this paper was presented in Pune, there was a hue and cry. And my subsequent boss, Professor R.C. Gupta, literally shot everyone down, saying this is a criminal act. Yes. When I went, I started working with him. I started doing primary internal fixation in fractures at Allahabad. And ultimately, he came down to me. He was magnanimous enough to tell me what you are saying has some weight. So this is how it comes out. A very small example. I was just reading the WHO. They say pyrazinamide has got a bioavailability life of 42 days. Right? The WHO is coming out with interrupted treatment to of tuberculosis. DOT, SAT, whatever things. Right? Why can't we in India, which has the highest population of tuberculosis, come out with this? Why do we not give a thought for the future? Why do we not give pyrazinamide after 21 days? Why? Imagine the if this comes out to be true, the amount of financial implications and a new lead to the world. Why can't this? This will all come out from our research. Thank you.
Sir, again, I am telling you, I am talking about India. I am not talking about Western world. I am talking about 85%. I am not talking about 15% who are doing good work. I am talking about MDMS in only MDMS thesis. I am not talking about MPhil, PhD and all. Now, I will come further and tell you what we can do. And as Dr. Sherwani said, whatever he has presented, you see, everything is important. Education for an MDMS student, out of us, how many go in for academics? Hardly 5 to 10%, 90% of us, of our postgraduates, do not go for academics, right? So that is what I am coming to. Now there is a big difference between what should be done and the reality of practical feasibility. I am talking about practical feasibility. Instead of purpose, we focus on policies. Instead of being free to create, we impose constraints that squeeze the life out of us. What can we do? What changes can we do? A radical change, instead of talking of impractical do's and don'ts. Should we resist change for the sake of it? Or should we resist because it has become mandatory and it was part of our curriculum? Why should we just continue with the job just because we are doing it for decades or convention? Can we do away with PG thesis? MD, MS thesis, should we continue? Answer is no. Super speciality thesis, DMMCH, yes. PhD, yes. That is what brings in what Dr. A.M. Verma was talking about. Now, proposed alternative to MDMS thesis. For 3 years residency program, first year residency, allotment of the mentor. Only academic oriented students should be allowed to go. They should find out who is academic oriented, who is thinking of going into academics rather than going into private practice. Only academic oriented students should be allowed to go in for research, and there should be separate 6 month period for research. For I'm telling you, according to the Western, in Western world, we have 1 year of separate, in, out of 5 year of training program, 1 year is only for research. That is what I want in India. There should be separate 6 month period for research for resident pursuing postgraduate graduation clinical esteem. Residents need to be trained in electronic medical records so that they can make full use of CPMS and record keeping and data entry. Once the resident is settled in the department in a month, they should be given formal training, as Dr. Sherwani said, in research methodology, training research and good paper writing. That does not mean that they should write thesis, but training is a must, I agree with you, which can be done by making a curriculum of 1 month within 3 months of their joining at the institutional level to maintain uniformity. And this should be followed by the theory and practical problem-oriented evaluation in this area. This is what is important, once in a year or as a part of internal assessment. Mandatory requirement for every resident should be one published accepted research paper in a peer-reviewed index journal and two oral poster presentations in at least two national conferences in the entire 3 year tenure to be completed before last 6 months of residency, and this should be done under the guidance of designated faculty in the first year that has been done, who has been a mentor of that student. And this is in addition to the regular journal clubs, grand rounds and other training and teaching schedules on the individual department, where we'll teach the resident about those things rather than make him write a thesis. Thank you.
Yeah, maybe both of you, if you are there, sir, please be there. I'll make some comments only after Dr. Sherwani.
No, I'm happy Professor Sharma has accepted that thesis or something like thesis is necessary. Well, some people may not like the name thesis. I mean, when we are writing MD-MS thesis, it's not at par with the PhD thesis. I totally agree on that. And certainly, there should be a dedicated time, almost 1 year or maybe 6 months for research. Because without research and thesis writing, our boys will not be able to learn a bit of academics. You know, some people will go in academics full time, but the people who are not going into academics, just now I saw two speakers before this debate, they are not full-time in academic, but their contributions are very well recognized. So they all need to be sensitized. So our MD-MS thesis is not of the level of the PhD. So let it continue like that. Certainly, if somebody is going into academics, suggest another 1 year after that. Because, you know, in India, 3 years is a very short period of time for training as a postgraduate. I remember when I went to Liverpool, one of my consultants smiled, "Oh, are you a consultant in India?" I mean, I was young at that time. He smiled and I said, "Yes, I am," because I didn't realize what he was saying. And you see, I'm very impressed with the young Indian consultants. Because, you know, there by the time you become a consultant, you must have spent at least 6 to 7 years
Dr. Sherwani, yeah, you are right, absolutely right. I am interested to know, are there any postgraduates among the audience? And it's very important
before,
to take their
advice. Only one comment more.
Yes.
You give me a topic, in 20,000 rupees, I'll give you the best thesis available in the world.
That is the corruption of our system.
No,
that about, is what is happening.
No,
that is what is happening.
We will discuss that also. That is besides the point. Yes, doctor, please. I think I'm happy if all of you come forward and give your comments. Come one by one.
So myself, a final postgraduate.
And come to the mic also. Yes, please.
I just wanted to, I don't have a question per se, but I have few doubts about thesis. Like, why do you want to make it as compulsion? Because what I feel is, when you make it as a compulsion, now there comes a problem that manipulations, all these increased number of cases, all these occur. Rather than, instead of making it as compulsion, give them some accreditation. Like as the IOCON conference has some 24 hours of accreditation hours, give the person some accreditation hours. Don't make it as compulsion, so that it becomes like a value. That if a person has this much of accreditation hours, that means that he is having Like, it doesn't account for money or whatever, but it gives a more value to that person. That's what I feel.
I think it's not very difficult to answer, Dr. Sherwani. Why should it be made compulsory?
There are certain commitments in life which you will realize with time. We are conducting the MD-MS degree as part of the curriculum. And so far, this is a part of the curriculum. Unless it is compulsory, many people will wriggle out of
it. Absolutely, I do agree with him.
Again, you see, compulsion does not mean that it should be a thesis. I mean, you should have some research work. There's no confusion.
The present rules.
What I'm against is thesis.
I was a member of the MCI. The present rules say a dissertation is submission and acceptance is essential for part one. Right? So, till the time, we may have any number of debates here, thesis writing against, but this is compulsory for the MS. It is also compulsory for the DNB. A dissertation must be accepted. Don't use the word thesis, use the word dissertation. Whatever word. But remember one thing, like Dr. Sharma said, for you identify the postgraduates who are interested in academics, have got an academic inclination. I don't agree. How can you assure a person with academic inclination that he will get an academic post and a person without academic inclination will not get a faculty post? So, given the present scenario, political scenario in our country, reservations at every stage, every level of manipulation, how can you ensure this? No, let us have it for everyone. Some briefing. Those who are interested will go further, either by compulsion or by interest, if they happen to be on the faculty. Others will simply have a scientific outlook. Yes, I am doing this work in my clinical practice. I am drawing this conclusion. So unless your mind does not know, your eyes will not see. Yes, so sir. This is the present today.
Sir, my one more question to Sherwani sir again. Sir, do you feel, in your opinion, thesis, when you're giving a thesis to a postgraduate, it should be a different topic or a common topic which has been done? What do you feel, sir?
It should be a topic, but every student should take different topics. And the burning topic, burning problems at that moment. But the topic should not be very complicated and should not be very time consuming. This is what I feel.
Yes, sir. So just to add it to that, what I feel from my side is, since it's a 3 years of post-graduation, what I feel when a postgraduate takes a common topic, like as for example in IM intramedullary interlocking nailing, suppose of a femur, if he takes, by the time he finishes his post-graduation, he'll be mastering that technique because he'll be done with all the references, everything. So what I feel, instead of taking a very uncommon or a very new subject for a thesis, it will be better to take a common like a hemiarthroplasty or a shaft tibia, shaft femur, whichever. Because by the time he finishes, he will be done with the entire concept about the
The answer is yes and no both. Because Dr. Sir, please sit down because we are now concluding. We have to go over there. See, it may not be agreeable, I tell you. Thesis means you are exploring something new also. And from your thesis, it's possible, even though it said 15% something, really they will do some good work, good publication in an index journal. If you continue the topic, like I am getting hundreds of theses like this, plating versus intramedullary nailing, 6 months follow-up in the fracture shaft humerus. All of us, okay, this and that. No, not like that. Number two, what you said, okay, you will become the master. You and then you can continue that practice in future. That is not also true also. If you want to learn something, you can learn later also. And it is not necessary that you will continue with the same subject which you have undertaken during this also. And no, before I give to Professor Verma, my concluding remarks are, thesis, whether we call it thesis or dissertation or research or whatever it must be there. The reason being, remember, when you are joining, just imagine, an intern is joining a department for postgraduation. Think about his mindset. He has done undergraduation, MBBS, and the internship. How serious he was, how much he knew. One has to change the mindset. To change the mindset and to promote and to towards, using this word research, probably is not very good. Are we, what he said, are we doing really doing the research? Even the, is the faculty doing the research? Say some sort of acclimatization, sensitization, that was the word Dr. Sherwani used, a very good word. Sensitization to a student for the subject, because this is sort of a learning methodology, what you said, that he learned so many things which he was totally unaware during his UG level. It should be there. Then the only second thing is whether it should be compulsory or not. Personally, I feel in our country, unless there is this danda behind, unless you make it compulsory, probably nobody will do anything.
I agree with Dr. Saraf, and the topic for thesis should not be too technical.
Sir, MCI says original research work.
What does the word research mean? Research.
Whatever it is.
So, I am telling you, you see a patient of osteoarthritis of the knee, very common. Have you noticed its association with varicose veins? Why can't we do something on intraosseous pressure as a cause of osteoarthrosis etiology? So it has to be, you just have to see. You see so many rickshaw pullers having osteoarthrosis deformities with huge varicose veins. Why don't you investigate that? And I'm sure you will come out with something. I gave a thesis on flat feet. I was standing on the bridge. I belong to a place where Kumbh Mela and Magh Mela is held. I was standing on the bridge. I saw two people, the footprints. One had a full impression of a flat feet, the other had of a normal feet. And that gave me an idea. I gave a thesis, I came out with an index. You could grade your incipient flat feet and flat feet which are unfit for service. So this is how you get those ideas. You have to keep your mind open and give thesis topics on projects which can be carried out. I remember my own thesis in 1971 was on tissue culture, calcitonin, which is now coming today. So I never knew anything, but I had to do it. So not these topics.
So thank you very much. Very good. We enjoyed it.
Thank you, Dr. Abrar. So the topic allotted to me was adolescent idiopathic scoliosis, the current concepts in surgical planning. When you look at the management of scoliosis over the years, over the centuries, it's really very, very fascinating, right from the AD time, the Galen's treatment modality, to the localizer cast research time in the early 40s and 50s, to Harrington rod in 60s and 70s, to Leakey and Saba and Hartzell rectangle straightening the spine up, to the modular posterior systems till the present day time, when the treatment as the current practice is to treat these deformities with these strong manipulative pedicular screw rod techniques, and that's what the current practice is all about. Similarly, lots of classifications evolved over the years, and what is stabilized now is the Lenke system of classification, and that is the gold standard as of now, and it gives guidelines to where to and how to fuse different kinds of curves, and I'll take you through these. And it is a difficult classification to remember if you start off, but once you read more and more, it's the conceptual understanding which is important. So basically, though he covers about 42 different types of curves, basically there are six different curve types, and the type one is the main thoracic curve, and type 2 is the double thoracic, and together they found about 70% of all the curves. Then comes the double majors, the triple major, thoracolumbar lumbar, the type 5 is where the controversy about anterior to posterior comes in, and 4 and 6 are the relatively less known curves as such. So basically you're looking at the main thoracic curve and how to treat this. Also what Lenke looked at was very interestingly the lumbar modifiers. So there's an S curve, there's a main thoracic curve and an additional lumbar curve. How do you look at those? And he devised that in terms of a CSVL, the central sacral vertebral line. And in the lumbar curve, if the apex lies within, if the apical vertebra, if it lies within the CSL, it's A. If it just touches the CSVL, it is B. And simplistically, the C is the one which you should be very, very aware of, because is this a double thoracic curve, double major curve, or is this a main thoracic curve with a lumbar modifier, is where the controversy occurs. And the C ones are ones where you really need to focus. Then the Lenke classification also looks at the sagittal profile of these patients and divides into a normal N minus and N plus. As we go along, we'll deal with all this. It's also very, very important to really look at, you do not operate in all these curves. Surgery is restricted to curves more than 40, 50 degrees. Having said that, there's no rule as such. Why 50 degrees or 40 degrees? Because, you know, that's the type of Cobb's angle beyond which you will get structural changes, you'll get rotational changes, the rib arm deformity occurs. Below 30 degrees, there's hardly any deformity noticeable to the patient as such. Between 30 to 50 degrees, people try to put that as a gray zone. You can either keep them under observation. Some people are very aggressive, would operate on a 40 degree curve, provided there is some rotation and a prominent thoracic right-sided hump there. But by and large, you treat them with braces, and braces are still into practice. But the current practice for AIS correction is pedicular screw rod construct. And my file is to look at today to preoperative planning, which is very, very important. It is mandatory now to treat all these curves, that look at all these curves with these long standing full spine X-rays. Earlier the long films were not available in India. Now with the digital X-rays, you can get a screw thing. You have to look at your Cobb's angle, you got to measure your Cobb's angle. And also, which is very important, is our bending films. The bending films classically, and Lenke and everybody uses it, most of the people uses this, is a supine bending films, left and lateral. Yes, there's a lot of talk about traction films, a lot of talk about fulcrum bending, but the supine bending films give you all the information as such. And why is it useful? So this is a major curve. The larger curves becomes a major curve, and the minor curves are the smaller curves. Now the bending films gives you whether there are structural changes or not, particularly in the minor curves, very, very important. So this curve, for example, is 40 degrees, bends down on the opposite side to a 38 degrees. So this is a fairly rigid and a structural curve. That is how structural curves are defined as such. So according to the Lenke's guideline, all major curves need to be fused because they are structural. What about minor curves? Minor curves which are structural will have to be fused. The ones which are non-structural, then you leave them on, or you do not do anything to them, because spontaneously they will sort of correct. And what again, what are the structural curves? If on side bending you get a corrected curve which is more than 25 degrees, then they are structural curves. Simplistically, that's how you look at these curves. But before we move on to fusion levels, there are some definitions we need to look at. We all know what end vertebrae are. Maximum tilted vertebrae towards the concavity. On the basis of this, you define your Cobb's angle, right? We all know that. What is important here is to define stable vertebra and neutral vertebra, particularly when you have an S-shaped double curve right, a thoracic and a lumbar curve, then these come into action, and then these come into sort of prominence when you decide which curve to fuel. Now, stable vertebra is the most cephalate vertebra that is most closely bisected by the central sacral vertical line, CSVL. Now, if you notice the CSVL, now if you notice here, there are actually two stable vertebra. There's one lower down, probably L4 or L5, and there's one higher up there. So actually, you're looking at this cephalade most and not this, because actually you're going to fuse to the stable vertebra, if you see. So that is what a stable vertebra is. Now, a neutral vertebra, usually above that, sometimes neutral and stable vertebra are the same, but usually cephalate to that, and it's the first vertebra without any rotation when you're moving away from the apex. So that's what a neutral vertebra is. Would look something like an end vertebra, but that's the neutral vertebra is called neutral because there's one curve here, end vertebra, and there's another curve here. So that's the neutral area and it will be less protected. That's what neutral vertebra is. So now the tendency is not to fuse to the stable vertebra, but to neutral vertebra, and we'll come to that. Also, it's very important to understand the Harrington, the whole 50s, 60s, Harrington's issue of stable zone of Harrington. Now, Harrington defined that if you drop two lines or you make two lines parallel to the S1 body up and down, it gives you a zone, and any vertebra which falls in this zone of the stable zone is a stable vertebra. All vertebra that are outside the stable zone is an unstable vertebra and has to be fused. Okay. Now, that would then bring you on to the newer concept of fusion levels. And if you look at the main thoracic curve, and you're looking at it as a Lenki type 1 or King's 3 type of curve, these have just the main thoracic component, and the lumbar component does not cross the midline. And the standard treatment was defined by King, that you fuse to a stable vertebra, something similar to what Harrington was doing. But that would have meant that you go right down to L4 or L5, and you lose very precious motion segments. So the new concept with pedicular system came and was given by Suk and also Lenki, is you can go ahead and fuse to the neutral vertebra or even NV-1. So your fusion starts moving more proximally. But the idea is to preserve your motion segments in the lumbar spine, and that's what you were doing. So with strong pedicular system, you can get away fusing the N neutral vertebra, which is not very stable, but with instrumentation you can bring it over, and your parallelity of the disc space can be maintained. And that's what the concept was, of fusing to neutral, or even with D rotators now fusing to NV- or NV-2. Now take the example of this type 1, a main thoracic curve, which is extending into the lumbar spine. And if you draw the zone of Harrington zone, you would see that the stable zone would be L4, and you'd land up fusing from T1 to L4 if you're using Harrington's, or if any you were, the same system was used for your hooks when hooks were being used by the Cottrell Dubuisson system. So you would fuse long from T1 to L4. Now, vending films come in is as a major help. Sorry, Kiara. What's happening? Anyway, so it's got stuck. Something wrong here. Anyway, so if you're looking at actually what we did, I'll just go back. The things are not moving here. So. Okay, so actually, if you really have to go to neutral vertebra, then if you with the modern pedicular screw system, you can stop short at the neutral vertebra L2 or even L3, or you can go into the L2 type. But having said that, you must take care when you want to stop at N1 or N2 that you do not stop at the apex of the curve. Then there'll be a tendency to sort of progress very rapidly. Okay, so I move on. But whatever you do, you can use your instrumentation, balance your curves and centralize your curve. But what would help you to maintain the curve over a period of time is the standard fusion. That means you do biological fusion. Segmented vertebra should be fused into one block, and that is done by, of course, the ALOGE technique of age-old technique of facial fusion, as well as laying autologous bone on a decorticate lumbar spine. Then brings us to what is selective thoracic fusion. There's a lot of talk going on about selective thoracic fusion. Basically, what selective thoracic fusion means, it's usually applicable in S type of curves. That means there will be thoracic curve and there will be a lumbar curve. They would be deviating off the midline. The question is, can you just fuse the thoracic curve and save your lumbar motion curves as such? And that is more applicable basically to type 1C and type 2C. Type 2C is the lower level is exactly the same as 1C. It's at the top level where you have an additional proximal thoracic curve, and I will come to that later on. And 70% of your curves would lie in this category. So you would have to look at most of your AIS with selective thoracic fusion in view. Now what happens is when the lumbar spine is flexible, in all these 1C types and 2C types, the lumbar spine curve is there, it's a minor curve, it stands out and you feel like going in and fusing it. But when you bend them, the bending force will show you that the bending is less than 25 degrees. That means these lumbar curves are flexible. So you need not go into the lumbar curves, and you can just do fusion to the thoracic spine like here to the thoracic vertebra like this. Now this looks like a double major lengthy type 3 curve. You see 52 degree and a 40 degree curve. But when you see the bending films and you see it bends down to 22 degrees. So obviously according to Lenke's description, this is a minor curve which is flexible curve. So you can just stop at the neutral vertebra, which would be about L1, or you can go even to T12. And that's what we did. I tend to cross the lumbosacral junction and get a hold in L1 and not losing much, so that your lumbosacral junction is addressed and don't stop at L4. Now, as you see what happens to the lumbar spine, the 46 degree curve was brought down to 29 degrees over a period of time, a year and a year and a half, then subsequently gets corrected spontaneously. So you don't, and you save vital lumbar motion segments. Then next comes the proximal fusion level for the main thoracic curve, the type 1s and the type 2. The upper end vertebra is, if it is below T4, and if the shoulder are level, that will be the classical mid-thoracic type of fusion. Then in which case you have to fuse, you can fuse one above the proximal end vertebra. That's the standard treatment carried on from Harrington days. But the important thing is the shoulder should have to be sort of squared, should not be dipped, and the end vertebra should be below T4. If the end vertebra goes above T4, and if there's a proximal thoracic curve which bends down to more than 25 degrees, then obviously it then falls into a Lenke type 2, so that there's a double thoracic curve. That's the main thoracic and that's the proximal thoracic, in which case the shoulders would be tilted. So the right side, the convex side shoulder, the right side shoulder would be tilted. If there's a main thoracic curve, severe main thoracic curve, the left side shoulder would curve. Because of the secondary curve here in the upper thoracic spine, the shoulder tilts to the concave side. Now when you get a disbalanced shoulder and you just correct up to T4, the primary curve, and distract it, this shoulder will further go down. So it's very, very important to recognize this Lenke type 2 curve, the rigid proximal curve, in which case you'd have to go up and extend your fusion to T2 or T1. as was done in this case. You see the proximal thoracic curve, you must pay attention to that, 38 degrees, and it bending films maximum it goes down to 28 degrees. So that is, according to the criteria, more than 25 degrees. So that's a rigid structural curve, and you do need to go up to T1 or T2, as we did. We usually take a hook on the top to prevent junctional kyphosis. That's another issue at all. So that this was the pre-op and the post-op squaring of the shoulder. Then you come to the third type, the Lenkey type 3 curve. Now this is a double thoracic curve like 1C, but there's a difference there. In three Lenkey's curve, this lumbar curve will not bend. It's also structural. It will not bend up to 25 or less. So that has to be treated as a double curve, and the fusion has to extend all the way down. Lumbar curve has to fuse. You have to make a concerted effort to stop at L4, because if you don't want to fuse the L5 S1 junction, preserve motion segments, at least two motion segments there. The modern pedicle screw rod system will allow you to stop at L4, and in which case you'll be able to horizontalize the L4 vertebra and make it neutral, and that's what this picture shows. The lumbar curve is 58, bending down to 38. So it's a Lenkey type 3 double major curves, and you have to go down to the lumbar curve L4 to fuse it, and you lose it. So now again recapitulate, I'll try and hammer this to you. What is the difference between these two type of curves? They look so similar there. But if you do the good bending films, in the one on the left, the lumbar curve corrects down to 25, suggesting that this is a non-structural curve. And if you look at carefully the apical vertebra, there's not much rotation there. So that's another indication that this is a non-structural curve, and that makes it a Lenkey 1C curve, right? Whereas in the right side, it corrects down only to 40 degrees, and you can see the rotation of the apical vertebra there. So this is a structural minor curve in making it the L3C. And there in this type of 1C, you can preserve your lumbar spine and the motion segment, but here you have to go down to L4, and that's the difference. And that's what is called the selective thoracic fusion. Then quickly going down to Lenkey 5, there's a thoracolumbar curve, and the dictum is, and CL Sook earlier would fuse one above or one below the end vertebra, all posteriorly. Now people are even moving on to end-to-end vertebra. So you can fix very well and align in by fixing going down to L3 or from the back. But a lot of people are doing these curves, the Lenkey type 5 anteriorly, and it's very amenable to very good correction. You get excellent correction, and you can stop at L3. That means you fuse from the end vertebra to end vertebra, what the spine surgeons call it as cobs to cobs. So you fuse short anteriorly, you correct well where the deformity is, rotation is, and you save motion segments. Okay, but there's still a lot of controversy, anterior versus posterior. Those who vouch by anterior say that the anterior approach can result in a mean shorter fusion of 1.5 vertebra can be saved. Also, the correction of the thoracic curve proximally may be better following anterior fusion. However, the ones which use propose posterior fusion, they suggest the same thing can be done by posterior correction also. And lastly, coming to rigid scoliosis, defining rigid scoliosis are cobs more than 70-80 degrees with bending films correction is less than 30 degrees is what a rigid curve is. Classically, rigid curves were always dealt with an anterior release and a posterior instrumentation. And for me, and for surgeons like us, and Sergeant is not here, Sergeant also does it, a lot of us still use anterior release and posterior, it loses of your curve and you get a very good correction as such. And here's an example, a 90 degree curve, loosened anteriorly, then an anterior release there, and you see the thoracotomy incision there and corrected well. Hey, thanks, Sanjay. Thanks a lot. And so anterior release still has a place. There's a lot of controversy. the newer articles from the Keith Bridwell, Lenki group, followed by Bavachi, and even Selsuk, they say you can all do this posteriorly using multiple osteotomy, what they call a Ponti's osteotomy. There's a session on osteotomy, so I won't discuss that. So Ponti's osteotomy lets you loosen it all from the back, so there's no need to do anterior releases, because anterior release, if you go anteriorly transthoracic, there's always jeopardization of the pulmonary function test. But in my hand, anterior release is a very good surgery, and I still do it. Of course, vertebral column dissection, if the deformities are very, very large, and all this can be done posteriorly, but be wary. These are dangerous procedures. Neurological deficits do occur when you resort to this. So you have to do a close spinal cord monitoring, and especially with the, or you can do it with the wake-up test also, combine it together. 160-degree curve. I would always do an anterior release even on these. And there's the evidence. I do it at a stage. So you can see how much is the correction. 160 corrects down to 76 degrees. So about 30-35% correction by anterior release alone. And then you go on the back and do multiple osteotomies, a Ponti's, or add a PSO if the curve is so bad, and then you will be able to correct these fairly decently. So in summary, these complicated cases, AIS is a multi-directional deformity. Team effort is required, careful evaluation, understanding of the curve lets you classify for understanding the curve, and then you'll be able to correct them. You have to rationalize it, try to look for safe motion lumbar segments, because 70% of your curves are going to have a lumbar modifier, and try to save those. Selective thoracic fusion is the treatment of choice. Proximal level, you have to balance your shoulders. So whether you want to go to T1, T2 or stop lower down is an issue. Rigid curves, anterior release are still very much prevalent, and a lot of the old time surgeons are still doing it, but you can all do it by posterior instrumentation by introducing osteotomies. Of course, near advances are developing. The vertebral rotation, the VCR, the the MIS system to correct the deformities, and also robotics are coming up. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for the excellent talk.
Thank my team members.
Any questions? Okay, then we are going to start our next session. Dr. Hegde is not here, sir.
Kya karna? Achha, so aisa karo. I'll just load my few of the early onset scoliosis, we can discuss that. Yes. So you move on to the next one. Give me some time. I'll load I have got a few cases, so we can discuss if Sergeant is not here. Anybody has brought some EOS? No. I'll do that. So we can just quickly discuss that in for 15 minutes.
Which lecture? There are only four people here.
Yeah.
We are starting this one.
Get somebody else by the
okay.
Let Suresh start.
Yeah, you can make your.
He can make his presentation. Meanwhile, I'll load it there.
Yeah, sure.
I'll load a few cases.
Okay.
Sir, it's a slide.
Suresh.
तू कर रहा है
सुरेश
या
ये सुरेश
लास्ट में
43 है देयर इज स्लाइड
कहां का डिस्कशन था मेजर डिस्कशन
या क्या
फाइनल डिस्कशन था देन दैट वाज चेंज्ड टू